That's Terry. And you must be... Oh, that's all right. The doctors told me your name anyways. Don't worry. I'm not a psychiatrist. I just help them out every once in a while. They thought that having someone normal to talk to would do you some good. You know, someone like me that actually lives in the outside world. Believe me, I know they're not that much fun to talk to. They tell me that you never say anything except for when you ask when you get to leave. Let me tell you something, kid. It's going to be a long time if you don't start talking. And I know what you're thinking. This place feels like a prison. Well, that's not their fault, you know. They're just doing their job. Look, kid. I know you don't want to be here. Hey, I don't want to be here either. I should be out playing basketball with a couple of my friends. But instead, they called me down here to talk to you. And I would leave, too, but I know that's exactly what you want me to do. And don't worry, I'm not going to make you talk about all your problems. I'm not going to try to be your friend, either. All I have to do is tell you a story. So listen, or don't listen. I really don't care. Just don't try to break out or do anything stupid. It'll go a lot quicker that way. And don't interrupt with any smart-aleck comments, either. I hate that. So, let's get down to business. A couple of years ago, I had this friend. His name was Dave Thompson. We'd been best friends for as long as I could remember. Anyway, he started to feel depressed after a while, sort of like you. He wasn't quite as lucky, though. He never ended up in a place like this.
So what do you think? You
want to
go to the concert or not?
Forget it. I've got tests to study for or something.
Tests to study for? On a Saturday night? Including you,
this
one, to study.
I don't know. Recently.
So how about this? Why don't you come to the concert with me on Saturday? And then on Sunday, we can do all the studying you want.
I said forget, okay? I've got things to do. Stuff to study for. See you around, okay?
Hey, Dave. You going to that concert tomorrow? I have to know. If I don't get those tickets off of Chris soon, he's gonna sell them to some guy in my English class.
Listen, man, I'm not going.
You're kidding me, right? You go berserk when the tickets sell out. And now you're passing up the chance to get the tickets at half price? You don't get a better deal than this.
Listen, I told you, I can't go, okay? See you after school.
All right, see you later. What's his problem?
He's acting a lot like that.
Is he okay?
He should be. Hot?
Hot?
Hi, Brenda. How's it going? Did you figure out what's wrong with Dave yet? Not yet.
Does everybody know about this but me?
Are you sure you don't know anything? You're his best friend. You ought to know something.
Well, I'll be sure to tell you if I figure anything out. For now, I have to get to class. I'm going to be late as it is.
No kidding. I've got to go, too. Bye.
Later. That was the first time I noticed anything was wrong with Dave. I didn't think much of it, though. As far as I was concerned, he was acting perfectly normal. He never was very direct when it came to women. And he'd been going out with Freddie for so long, I thought he might have been getting bored with her or something. I don't know. As far as I was concerned, I thought he was just trying to get rid of her.
Well, how's it going?
All right. So, what's going on between you and Brenda?
Nothing, it's fine.
Really? That's not what she says. She thinks you might be seeing someone behind her back.
What?
I don't blame her. The way you've been ignoring her lately.
Listen, man, I'm not seeing anybody else.
Then why are you ignoring her?
I don't know.
Well, there has to be some reason.
Not that I can think of.
Well, you better come up with an excuse, too. I heard that she's thinking of breaking up with you.
Well, maybe that might not be such a bad idea.
I don't get it, Dave. Are you just getting bored with her or what?
No, I'm not bored with her. It's just that I really don't care whether or not we stay together or not, that's all.
Well, there has to be some reason.
Not really.
Are you okay?
Yeah, what?
I don't know. You just seem a little out of it.
I'm fine.
You sure?
Yes, I'm sure. Hey, it's a good question.
Yeah, sure.
You ever think about God?
Sure, once in a while.
I mean, you know, do you ever think about why we're here and all that stuff? I mean, there's gotta be some reason.
Well, I guess I never really thought about it much. Are you sure you're okay?
Yeah,
Fine. Just forget that part out, okay?
It's a chemistry.
That's the first time I noticed anything was wrong with Dave. I guess you had to know him to know what I mean. First of all, when it came to Dave and women, he told me everything. You could point out almost any girl in the school, and I could tell him exactly what he thought about him. When him and Brenda got into a fight, I was always the first one to hear his side of the story. When he didn't tell me anything, I knew something had to be wrong. Also, when it came to Dave, he never talked about God. I mean, it's not like he hated him or anything. He just never talked about him. I guess it wasn't a good enough reason to stop talking to him, but I ignored him after that. I just didn't know what to say. Seen you there by your locker.
Well, I was there. Is there something wrong?
It's my dad. He got into a car accident.
Is he all right?
I don't know. The doctor said he's in critical condition.
He's gonna be okay?
I just said, I don't know. The doctors don't know anything either. I won't know anything until they do, all right?
Listen, you know that if you need anything,
Dave came from a pretty good family. My family, on the other hand, was pretty messed up. I won't go into detail, but let's just say that my father drank a lot. He treated me and my mom pretty badly. Still, I was worried about him. It's funny how things work that way. A few days later, when my dad died, I was pretty messed up.
Hey man, heard about your dad.
Yeah, I figured you would.
So how's it doing?
He died this morning. For a while, it looked like he was going to get better, but then he just gave up.
It happens. So what do I do this weekend?
My dad dies and that's all you can say?
Well, what do you want me to say?
Well, at least try to pretend that you're sorry.
I'm tired of pretending to be sorry, Terry. Did that a long time ago. Now, do you want to do something this weekend or not?
Well, actually, I thought I was going to go and see my dad's funeral, but you're right. Why bother? I don't believe this. What's wrong with you?
Please calm down, will you? You don't want to do anything, you just have to say so. It's like you don't have one of those problems around here.
I knew Dave was a little depressed, but at least he could have shown a little sympathy. I knew it wasn't a good enough reason, but I stopped talking to him after that. I just couldn't believe the way he'd been acting. After my father died, it seemed like the entire world just collapsed on me. Every night, my mom would go to sleep and cry, and I'd never know what to say. Me and Jamie, we got into fights all the time. It looked like we were going to break up. My grades in school dropped, as if they weren't bad enough already. What started out as a little pain ended up as a full-scale depression. I guess while all that happened, I forgot about Dave. I never thought about what he was going through.
that I found you.
What is it?
I just broke up with Dave.
Are you serious?
I wish I wasn't. He just stood there for a minute. And then he hit me.
He what?
And then he said, Terry's dad had the right idea. I think it's time to give up. Look, Terry, I'm really worried about him. If anything happens to him, I'll never forgive myself.
When did all this happen?
Just a little while ago.
Where is he now?
I don't know. I think he might have gone home.
Don't worry. I'll talk to him. Funny thing was, I wasn't worried. I was angry instead. I just couldn't understand why Dave was so depressed. I mean, he had a big house, plenty of people to hang out with, and even a good-looking girlfriend. He came from a great family, too, which was more than most people I live to say. When I went to his house that night, I wanted to tell him off. Somebody had to tell him how good he had it. Looking back at things now, I wish I would have handled things differently. Dave, what are you doing?
What does it look like I'm doing?
Well, why are you doing this?
No better question. Why not?
Because you have too much to lose, that's why.
Yeah, like what?
I don't know. You've got a great life. You've got a big house, decent grades. Brenda?
Brenda broke up with me.
That's not why you're doing this, is it?
I don't care about Brenda.
Yeah, but she cares about you. She just doesn't know how to show it anymore because you won't let her.
Where in the world have you been the past couple of weeks? I've been around. I mean, you talk about Brenda caring so much, you don't even bother to stop by once.
Well, I'm sorry. I've had some problems of my own. Besides, you were the one that was mad at me. I thought you'd talk to me once you got over it.
I was mad at you? No, you were mad at me, remember? You know, you talk about everybody caring so much all the time. You never even liked your father in the first place.
Well, yeah, that was before.
Before what? Before I died? You were such a jerk. You hate him all your life, and you tell everybody what a great guy he is once he's dead. Is that what's going to be like when I'm gone, too?
I thought he was a great guy when he was alive, too. I just didn't know it.
You are so pathetic.
Look, I came here to help.
Help what? I don't even know what's wrong.
Look, when I came in here, you're holding that knife to your wrist. I call that a problem.
For me or for you?
For you.
What are you going to do? March in here and give some big speech about how I should run my life? So now you all of a sudden care when you've been ignoring me all this time?
Ignoring what, Dave? You don't let anyone talk to you anymore. What am I supposed to do, read your mind?
You know something's wrong, don't you?
Yeah.
And when did you first notice this?
I don't know, a while ago.
So why didn't you say it?
What was I supposed to say, Dave? I had problems of my own.
I don't believe this.
You're never all that bad. Somebody
ought to- Oh, what? Not too sensitive to me? Come on, man, hit me.
Is that what you do now? You hit people? Just like you hit Brenda?
Don't even talk to me about Brenda.
What were you thinking? She didn't want to hurt you.
See, I told you I didn't even talk about her. Oh.
What do you know about pain? I don't remember anyone in your family dying.
I think you know everything.
Take another step closer. I dare you.
Are you serious?
Try me.
So this is your way of talking some sense into me, huh? Temper, temper.
Oh my God! Oh my God! Dave!
You stink!
Oh my God!
You're gonna be okay, Dave!
Oh my God.
Just hold on, Dave! Just hold on!
I gotta get some help. I'm gonna get some help, Dave. Just hold on. Just hold on a little bit longer, Dave. I'll never forget that night. It took the ambulance 10 minutes to get there. 10 minutes! By that time, David stopped breathing completely. I wanted to ride along with him to the hospital, but they wouldn't let me. I spent the night in the police station. Tried to hang myself twice. The second time, they even gave me my own personal security guard. It was the longest night of my life. In court, I was convicted of voluntary manslaughter for the death of David Thompson. He died of multiple stab wounds to the chest, which damaged the heart muscle and caused the lungs to fill with blood. The doctors tried to revive him, but they said he didn't put up much of a fight. As for me, I was put into a mental institution. I guess I need more help than a jail sentence. That was a long time ago. I live on my own now. I even have my own job. My psychiatrist checks up on me once in a while, but besides for that, I'm completely independent. Well, that's it. That's my story. So what do you think? Don't you ever say anything? You know, you really tick me off. Don't you get it? You don't have to mess things up like I did. You can still change things. You may think you're being smart by just sitting there. Well, that's bull. It's not the pain that's killing you. It's the part of you that won't do anything about it. Don't sit there and look like you don't know what I'm talking about. It's a part of you that's just sitting back and watching your whole life destroy itself. It's like a scientist watching some sort of morbid experiment. It just stands there. You get worse and worse, but it never does anything to help. That's the part of yourself that you have to change. If you don't, things will never get better. You've probably already tried to get people's attention. But let me tell you something, kid. You can scream for help in 1,000 different ways. But that won't do you any good if you don't let them help you. You've probably tried to help yourself already. And it didn't work. That's why you're here. Here, there are people that can help you live with the pain and even take most of it away. But that won't happen unless you let them. I know what you're going through. You've been through a lot, and now they try to pick you apart and analyze you like some sort of laboratory animal. The pain is unbearable, and you just want to get out. Let me ask you something. The pain's going to be there if you're here or not. Do you really want to face things on your own? You have so much of your life ahead of you. I know you've probably heard that before, but it's true. I wish I was in your shoes. I wish I had a chance to change things before things got as bad as they did. You have a chance now that I'll never let myself have. You have a chance to change. You know, there are going to be parts of your life that you mess up so bad that you'll never forgive yourself. But you're going to have to learn to move on. For me, it wasn't admitting what I did that was the worst. It was realizing that I hurt so many people when I pushed them away. It was knowing that I couldn't go back and change things. It took me a long time to learn how to live with my regret. Do you know why I'm here? I'm here because I have to make everything that happened worth something. I had to watch my best friend die in his own blood because I couldn't control my emotions. He died. And now I have to give something back. If that means I have to tear open my heart again and again, then I will until it makes a difference. Every night, I lay in my bed. I sit and stare at the ceiling and pray. I pray that Dave will forgive me, and that I've done enough to earn that forgiveness. I don't think I'll ever be able to forgive myself, knowing that he had to die in vain. I would really like to tear down the walls that you've built around yourself, but I can't. Only you can do that. All I can do is sit here and hope. I'd like to finish this off with some great piece of wisdom, but I don't know what else to say. The doctors are waiting. If any of this makes any difference to you, try to talk to them. But remember, I can't make you do anything. Take care of yourself, kid.
Good afternoon. I'm going to teach you to see what I think you should do at this time. Remember, see what I think you should do at this time.
He knows everything there is to know about this business. That's why I trust him. He'll show you around, tell you what's what. He'll see if you're really cut out for this line of work. My mortuary is trusted and respected by everyone in this town, and I don't have a doubt in my mind it's all thanks to him.
He sounds like a very respectable man.
Indeed he is. Why don't you come back around 6 o'clock? I'm sure he'll be here by then.
Hey, it was nice meeting you.
All right. Goodbye.
Bye.
Hello? Is anybody here?
You must be James. I'll be out in a minute. I'll be back.
Oh my.
It takes some getting used to, but it's not all that bad.
What are you doing?
Embalming. It's kind of simple, actually. Take it step by step.
Why is it smiling?
So it is. That's kind of rare. I've only seen it about a dozen times myself.
Oh, that's kind of creepy.
I read somewhere that the ancient Indian cultures believed the dead would smile and they had fulfilled their lifelong dream or destiny. Somewhere else I read that some scientists say it happens in the stages of rigor mortis. The muscles in their face contract and tighten, making it smile. It'll last for as long as the body can sustain it.
Oh.
They're semi-permanent, actually. I could do some light cosmetic surgery to get rid of it, but it takes so much time and money. Besides, I don't think he could afford it.
So, what's the weather supposed to be like tonight?
What? This doesn't seem like the kind of thing you'd be interested in. Why are you here?
I know it doesn't, but I'm desperate. You see, I've got this girlfriend and we're living together. I've got to help support her, but I can't get a job. I've been to several places, but nobody wants to hire me.
Yes, I know what you mean. I was in the same situation myself about 32 years ago.
Really? Are you married now?
No. She's gone. She got hit by a truck. I'd rather not talk about it now.
I'm sorry.
It's okay. It was a long time ago. Anyways, first make an incision here. Make sure it's deep enough to hit the artery. You'll know by probing your finger around a little. Some blood might spill out, but that's normal.
Isn't there something you can do about its face? I mean, just for now?
Of course.
Thanks. That smile is kind of giving me the spooks.
Anyway, insert the tube into the incision. This drains the blood up. It's just a plain old pump. Most of the time it's pretty quiet. If it starts to make some noise, just hit it a few times. That only happens from blood clots. This should just take a minute or two.
I can still feel it smiling under there. It's hard to imagine something like that could happen naturally.
Yes. You want to know something even stranger that happens more often?
What's that?
It just so happens I've seen the dead sit up on the table before. The muscles in their back and stomach contract and make them curl up like a dead leaf.
I'm glad he's not doing that now. I could probably throw up.
Yes, it happens. You can't let it get to you. This is about done. Next, remove the tube, remove the blood, reverse the pump, insert the fluid, insert the tube, and turn it on.
What is that stuff? It smells horrible.
Formaldehyde, mercuric chloride, zinc chloride, and alcohol.
Are you ever tempted to do stuff with the bodies?
You're not some sort of weirdo, are you?
No, I don't know. I was just curious, you know? Forget I ever mentioned it.
Just between you and me, sometimes, with the really ugly ones, the men, I put them in women's clothing and we dance the night away.
Oh!
Anyways, the facilities for the blood are in the back. I'll show you later. The preservatives are also stored in the back. I have to go to town for a few hours to get some supplies. And then I'm gone, I want you to sweep the floors, wipe down the desks and the coffins. If you get done early, have a seat and behave yourself. And James, this is your chance to really impress me.
Okay.
With a dead body and some girl.
Hey!
On one of our clients. Did you think it would be funny to put a dress on him?
Oh, Mr. Albert, he did not
do it! Sure he did! James, there's a few things I'd like to say to you. First, you're the most perverted sicko I've ever seen. I can't believe you try to blame Victor when it's obvious what's going on. No wonder you didn't have a job. Next, you've embarrassed me, my morgue, and my family name. You won't work for me or for anyone in this town again, I assure you!
Albert, let me explain, please!
Lastly, get out of here and don't come back ever again, dead or alive. Oh my God, I can't believe this happened. Vic, tell me this.
You've always respected me for my honesty, so I'm sorry. But it's all true.
My business is ruined! That was one very disturbed man.
Yes. The world is full of strange and crazy people.
Such a controversial topic like pilot adoption. You might think it's crazy to sit here and waste a half an hour watching such physics. But I guarantee, if you give me the next 30 minutes of your life, I'll not only make you reconsider the so-called social advantages of the Adopt a Hybrid program, I will change your life. You see, things are not always as simple as they appear. The plight of the highway adopter does not end when the highway adoption sign goes up, and not every love story has a happy ending. You must learn the truth of life. You must learn the moral of this story. The moral that will soon become perfectly clear. The moral that everybody wants to adopt a highway, and they don't think that there could be another way. Some people pick up garbage without their name on the street. Boy, isn't that neat? Isn't that neat? They don't understand why someone would need a sign to do the things that they do all the time. They just pick up garbage whenever they can. They pick it up and put it in a garbage can. Everybody wants to adopt a highway, and they don't know that there is another way. You can pick up garbage without your name on the street. Boy, isn't that neat? Isn't that neat? You can't help without an organization. All you need is a little motivation. You can pick up garbage any day. Adoption is a big commitment anyway. Probably don't have the proper clothing or tools. Please, don't be a fool. Don't be a fool. So if you want to adopt a highway, please remember that there is another way. You can pick up garbage with your name on the street. Boy, isn't that neat? Isn't that neat? Time to meet our protagonist. Enter Susan, a young housewife with a simple but terrible problem.
Time for breakfast, Barry.
Enter Barry, a man with an obsession.
I'm in a hurry, Susan. It's almost 6 o'clock.
You're going to see the highway again? Thought we could spend a day together.
Susan, this is the life of a highway adopter. You know that.
I never wanted to adopt a highway. Before we got married, we just do normal things.
I'm just trying to give something back to the community. Maybe if you cared about the community at all, you'd adopt a highway. Maybe if you cared all about what I do with my time, you'd join me.
You've got to be kidding me. Me, pick up garbage in 100 degree heat all day?
If you love me, you'd do it.
Fine, I'll try it. Maybe I'll like it.
What?
Come on, pay your course like a girl.
Thank you. people come and take the trash away, but these people, they aren't volunteers. They are oppressed, they are our citizens, they are the men and women of the highway. They pick up trash, cause we all want to make the best of the situation after arrest. We are oppressed, we are our citizens, we are the men and women of the highway. We pick up trash, because we all want to make the best of the situation after arrest.
Wake up, this world of freedom! Freedom!
Trash, enjoying the weather. It's a lovely day, isn't it?
Are you a highway doctor?
Actually, no. Yeah, I hate this. I'm in prison. Low security, and they sort of make me pick up trash as part of my punishment.
Wow, why are you in prison?
I accidentally dropped 20,000 pounds of industrial waste on SA 91 last June.
Accidentally?
Yeah, I know. It wasn't real smart. I don't plan on ever doing it again. Actually, I'm almost done with my sentence. I get out of jail in 2 days.
Well, what are you going to do then?
Well, to tell you the truth, I have no idea. I mean, I lost my house, I lost my job, I have no family.
Well, you know, I have a house in the country. Letting space with another person. You seem like such a nice guy. Maybe you can come stay with me for a while.
Well, are you serious? You don't even know me.
Well, yes, but I feel like I do.
mean, I feel like I want to know you. Let me introduce myself. My name is Susan.
Perry. Nice to meet you, Susan. Extremely nice. Susan. Susan!
I'm sorry. I have to go.
You will come and visit me tomorrow morning, won't you?
I promise, Perry. I'll be there.
Freedom will help.
Told Susan he couldn't lie. Not the first not a wonderful guy, but he just loves garbage. He soon dreamed and started to cry. He began to think she's gonna die. He couldn't figure out exactly why. He can love garbage, hot nights, hot fights. If Bear's gonna make things right, he better start before tomorrow. Harry gets out at 7:45. Susan found she wouldn't be late. She and Harry are gonna date. If Bear doesn't stop it, hot nights, hot fights, hot nights, hot fights, hot nights, hot fights. Susan doesn't hate him, but he doesn't hate him. Stop Susan before 8, or it will be too late. So, Susan, who will it be? Barry or Harry? Harry or Barry? Who do you want? You know. What were you thinking when you said you would marry Barry? Do you know of any nicer guys than Harry? Kind of scary. But Barry couldn't deserve you. He'll just abuse you. Someone. And Harry will never use you. And you should probably choose to see him more. Are you ready for choosing? Susan, I'm so afraid of losing a man that cares more about the role than you. Come on, Barry or Harry, Barry or Barry. You're so scared. If you make up your mind,
would you please shut up?
Would you please make up your mind? I can't stand the suspense.
Me, Barry or Harry, Harry or Barry. Is that a way I could possibly know? Barry. The one I married, I just really sort of visionary. But not a lot is broken secondary. And so I am thinking maybe it could be a noble cause. Leaning roads is not easy to do. And so I'm lucky to have a husband who thinks his highway is more important than his suit. What's the matter with Barry? Barry! How did he know that it's solitary? Can't you see I have no real option to choose? And Barry is ordinary.
And if Harry's in prison, doesn't that make him a little bit scary?
Harry is hardly scary. And I can do without your commentary. I get enough of it at home with Barry. And I can't take any more. Harry, on the contrary, really is quite sweet. Isn't all that neat? I wait for the day when we can meet again.
You know, that could be tomorrow.
And when Harry stands next to Barry, I realize it is necessary to go and ditch Barry. Because Harry is in sanitary. Well, not Barry. Oh, Harry, not so Barry. I love you.
Barry or Harry?
Thank you.
Never take back, and there is no prison term long enough for me. I'll serve until I die, because I couldn't say goodbye to the highway I like to call home. Listen to the road before you run. See, women are always right. That's why you have to listen to your road before your wife. Susan, I'm so sorry. I never meant for this to happen. I plan to live a better life, sending the moral of this story to theaters across the country. But you have to listen to me. The life of a highway adopter may not be the life for you. There is another way. This highway adoption sign will bring you nothing but pain. Can't you see that I'm completely ashamed? And if I had the chance to try again, I wouldn't be a highway adopter then. Don't make a commitment that is too big, or else your wife will say, you smell like a pig. Highway adoption is not for everyone. So please, if you have to adopt a highway, please, please be discreet. Please be discreet.
Everybody wants to adopt a highway, and they don't think that there could be another way. Some people pick up garbage without their name on the street. Boy, isn't that neat? Isn't that neat?
Probably you'll lose your spouse for life if you try to go against your wife.
Something extreme is good for you. You should find something more normal to do.
Watch TV or read a good book. Ask your wife if she wants you to cook.
Everybody wants to adopt a highway. They don't see that there is another way. You can pick up garbage without your name on the street. Boy, isn't that neat? Isn't that neat? So if you're walking on a highway one day, and a piece of garbage is in your way, if you think you won't be able to quit, please don't comment. Please don't comment. So if you want to adopt a highway, please remember that there is another way. You can pick up garbage without your name on the street. Boy, isn't that neat? Isn't that neat?
Susan!
Hello, baby. Hello.
It looks just like me.
Yes, it does. Smaller.
Well, yes.
It looks just like me. It has my hair.
Yes, it does.
I wonder if it would have been better off having your hair.
Your hair is lovely.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Hello, baby. Hello.
Come, what? Come, what?
Daddy's little baked potato.
Don't call it a baked potato.
It's a term of affection.
It isn't. It's a food. No one wants to be called a baked potato.
Well, it doesn't speak English.
The various books say that it should presume your child can understand you. We don't want to have problems in kindergarten or marriage because you called a baked potato.
Seems to me you're losing your sense of humor.
I just don't want to make the child insane, that's all. Bringing up a child is a delicate thing.
All right. You're not a baked potato, sweet pea. And you're not a sweet pea either. You're a baby. Baby. Baby.
I want a divorce.
What?
You heard me. I want a divorce.
Are you crazy? You've heard the statistics on children from broken homes. Do you want to do that to our child?
I don't feel ready for marriage. I didn't when we got married. I should have said no.
What? Is this postpartum depression?
Don't talk about postpartum depression. You know nothing about it. Men just don't understand things, do they, sweetie pie?
You, if I can't call it a potato, you can't call it a pie.
I didn't call it a pie.
Yes, you did. You said sweetie pie.
Sweetie pie is an expression. It isn't a pie. You don't go into a restaurant and order sweetie pie.
Why do you insist on winning every argument?
If I'm right, I'm right. It has nothing to do with winning. Men don't know how to argue. That's why they always end up hitting people.
I don't hit people.
Boys and men hit one another constantly. They attack one another in the street, they play football, and they wrestle on television. Beware of men, darling. Be glad that you're not ever going to be a man.
That's an awful thing to say. And isn't it a girl? I thought it was a boy.
We don't know what it is yet. The doctor said we could decide later.
You can't decide later. Gender is a fact, not a decision.
That's not what the doctor told me. He said something about the DNA molecules. They're splitting them differently now. He said if the DNA combined one way, the child would have testosterone, and then it would be a boy. Or else the DNA combines with estrogen, in which case it would be a girl. Or in some cases, the DNA combines with cobalt molecules, and then the child would become radioactive for 5,000 years and we'd have to send it out into orbit.
What are you talking about?
Can't you speak English? I'm married to an idiot. Your father's an idiot. Oh, God, why can't I meet a dark-haired man who's smarter than I am? Why did you go away? I don't like you.
I don't understand. We are making plans. The child's schooling, what playground to take it to, whether to let it play with toy gun, how to toilet train it.
Oh, God. Toilet training. I can't face it. We'll have to hire someone.
But we don't have any money to hire anyone.
But we'll have to earn the money.
But we can't. I was let go from work.
Well, you can get another job.
I need rest. I really don't feel able to work right now.
John, that's not practical.
I just want to go back to bed.
But John, you wanted to be responsible, don't you remember? Right after that week, you stayed behind the refrigerator. You came to me and said, the immaturities of my youth are over now, Helen. Let's make a baby. And then we did, don't you remember?
I need professional help. I want to go to McLean from Massachusetts. That's the institution James Taylor was in for a while. He seems so calm and tranquil when he gives his concerts. He has a summer's house on Martha's Vineyard. And when the doctor says I'm well enough, I can go to Martha's
Vineyard. John, think of your responsibility! I've got it, Brian. What should we do?
Sing to it.
There's no business like John.
A lullaby, sweetheart.
Tiny lullaby.
Hush, little baby, don't you cry. Mama's gonna give you a big black eye.
What happened? Is that the lyrics?
I know, but I can't remember the right one.
Oh, God! You didn't teach baby all the wrong words to everything. You can have trouble with the tears room.
Maybe we should hold it to comfort it.
You might drop it. I had a cocktail for breakfast.
Why did you have a cocktail?
You're always picking on me. I'm sorry I married you. I'm sorry I gave birth to the baby.
But we were... I love baby.
I love the baby. Won't stop making that noise. Shut up, baby. Shut up. Oh, God. Please help us.
Very kind to her.
And don't depend on Mommy, baby. She's not all there.
Now, what can I do for you?
I really haven't hired you yet, you know.
Don't worry, you will.
Going to work out.
What is it?
Nanny.
I think it's working out fine.
I don't think Nanny is a good person.
I heard that.
Please, we're trying to have a private conversation here.
Don't talk behind my back. I'll hire a lawyer. We'll slap an injunction against you.
Nanny, please, you deal with the baby. I'm not Helen and me figure this out.
I've finished comforting baby. Don't sleep, baby. Are you telling me in my face that I'm not a good person?
Well, maybe that's too strong, but I think you're too rough with baby. I mean, you just threw it in the bassinet.
Do you hear it crying?
No, but maybe it's fainted or something.
It's just resting, John.
You keep saying that, but I think you have it fainting. And it always has a look of panic on its face.
Don't tell me how to handle children. I got it down.
Nanny knows best, John. And she's helping me with my novel. She liked the first chapter, John.
I did. I thought it showed real promise.
And then, when we sell the novel, if we get a good deal for the paperback rights, we can buy a house in the country, and then we can have another baby.
Helen, Nanny seduced me this afternoon while you were out buying paper.
That's a lie.
It's the truth. I was unfaithful to you, Helen. I'm sorry.
I don't know how to cope with this.
So you can see what I don't feel comfortable with her here.
I don't know how to cope.
Please, it's all Nanny's fault.
I don't want to talk about this anymore. I'm going to the kitchen.
Well, things are in a fine mess.
You told her I didn't.
What we did was wrong.
It would have been fine if you hadn't said anything.
I feel guilty. It's wrong to cheat on your wife.
You're such a dullard. There's no right or wrong. There's only fun.
That can't be right. I mean, there are certain things that are intrinsically wrong. When we figure out what those things are, we're said to value.
Haven't you ever heard of the Brothers Karamazov? Ivan Karamazov realizes that because there is no God, everything is permitted.
I don't understand.
Everything is permitted.
Why did you do that?
Because I felt like it. Everything is permitted.
I'm taking the baby in the first chapter of my novel, and I'm leaving you.
Well, but it's all Nanny's fault. It won't happen again.
You obviously prefer Nanny to me, so as far as I'm concerned, it's over.
I love arguments.
But we have to stay together for the baby.
No! I'm taking the baby in my novel and you won't get any of the paperback rights at all. Goodbye.
The baby's asleep.
Or fainted. As you said, Nanny bats it around so.
But where will you go at this hour?
We'll sleep in the park. I don't care. I just have to get away from here. Get away from me.
But it's very cold outside. You'll catch pneumonia.
Well, I don't know. You don't die from pneumonia.
But you do. You do die from pneumonia.
Don't tell me what to do. I know what I'm doing.
Let her go. I know these hysterical mothers. She'll be back in a few minutes.
But it's very cold outside. They'll get very ill.
It's wrong to fuss too much as a parent. Baby will grow up afraid. Let him figure out some things for himself.
No, this is wrong.
Right, wrong. Where do you pick up these phrases?
Didn't they teach about Darwin in public school? The fish crawled out of the water covered in a viscous substance. Then bones and vertebrae were evolved, and then a male and female, and then dinosaurs. Or maybe dinosaurs before that. And then local governments and home box office and cable television and the nuclear space program. Where do you find Mike and Norman all that? Tell me. I fell in a puddle. I'm all wet.
Well, isn't Nora 5 minutes after the end of a doll's house?
I thought you were going to help me, and all you do is pick on me.
Good God, baby's soaking wet.
Of course it's wet. I told you, I fell in a puddle.
Helen is the worst mother, isn't she, baby?
Send a job here for me.
Now, enough of all this arguing. Now, we're going to get baby in some dry clothes and Helen in some dry clothes. We're going to take NyQuil and Quaaludes and get some sleep. We're going to discuss all these matters in the morning. Is that clear?
Yes, John.
Yes, John.
Very well. No more talking. God.
You have its feet in the armholes.
But the point is that it's dry, right?
The point is to do things right. You said no more talking. I want to go to sleep.
Very well, but in the morning we're going to kill Nanny.
Let's just have our NyQuil and not argue anymore.
Should we give baby NyQuil?
Well, I don't know. What does it say on the label?
I don't know. I can't read the small print. I need glasses.
Well, if you can't read it, then there's no solution, is there?
Why don't we just ask baby? Do you want some NyQuil, honey, do you?
It won't say, it's just staring back hostily. Why can't it be any happy, baby? John, you've dressed it all wrong. You barely move that way.
Well, anyway, good night, everybody.
Good night, Nanny. I love you. I hate you.
Night, Helen.
Hello, baby. Hello.
Who are you?
Oh, I'm just so upset. I'm very poor, and I just gave birth in a hospital to a little baby girl. My boy. And when I got home, there was no heat, and there was no furniture. There was just my German Shepherd. And he was really hungry, since I hadn't fed him in about a week. So I went up to the store to get some baby food and some dog food. But there was no furniture, so I left the baby on the floor. And when I got home, the dog had eaten the baby, and now I don't know what to do.
Have you told this to I'd start by doing that.
No, but I'm just so tired.
What's the matter with you? Why did you leave your baby on the floor?
Don't yell at me. I don't have any furniture.
Poor child. Come here. It's okay. We'll get you another baby. You'll adopt.
By the way, I'm not a fit mother.
It's okay. Everyone's allowed one mistake.
Where's the dog?
Oh, it's out in the hallway. Would you like to keep it?
Don't you bring that dog in here.
There's no reason to hold this woman's stupidity against that dog. That's just unfair. It sounds like a good watchdog.
Actually, it's always been quite vicious.
I think she's a terrible woman.
Well, please don't hate me. I feel very guilty. It's just that I really don't know any better. I never really listened to anything they taught me in school. Something about equal sides of an isosceles triangle. They don't have any furniture.
Oh, and you have such nice furniture. If I could just lay down and sleep for a while. Poor child. What's she doing here? We don't want her here.
Where's your sense of charity? This poor woman's going to have to live with her stupidity all the rest of her life. She may even go to prison where the police will hear of it all. Surely you wouldn't begrudge her of one night's safety and peace.
I suppose not. But can we make her leave in the morning?
We'll see. Go to bed.
Dog is barking.
Oh, I hear it now. There must smell, baby.
Oh, dear God.
I'm not hurt. He's just hungry. Do you have any red meat?
There might be some in the refrigerator.
Well, go get it and give it to him. Then I'll stop by. Oh, don't let him get your hand.
Where did you get the dog?
Oh, some awful people were beating it in the park. So I asked if I could have it.
And so they just gave it to you?
Yes. And then they beat me up for quite some time. 20 minutes, it seems. Time like that. And then the dog and I crawled back to the apartment and we've been together ever since.
Took the meat.
Oh, it really loves meat. I'm a vegetarian myself. I tried to make it eat Brussels sprouts and alfalfa for a while, but it didn't work out.
I think someone should change baby. It's made a mess.
Ugh. I don't want to. Let Nanny do it.
I don't want to do it either.
I'll do it. I love baby.
Oh, your baby's so grumpy. What's the matter, baby? Don't you like me?
It's very grouchy, baby. We're not very happy with it.
I know. I've got a little toy it might like. The nurses gave it to me in the hospital.
Look, baby, it's a little red thing in the jig. Don't you like that? Doesn't it make you smile?
I don't think baby likes me. Why don't you like me, baby?
Why don't you try reading to it? Babies love to read that too.
Okay.
I need a book, though. John, you better get up and look for work.
I just want to go to bed. Leave me alone.
John, that's not practical. Now get up and look at me.
Here's one. Now, if I promise to read this to you, do you promise you'll smile for me?
I want a divorce.
John,
you had one yesterday. Let's get one now.
That's not practical now. Baby needs a father, and I need financial support until I finish my novel.
Chapter 7. Shortly after Mommy Dearest won her Oscar for Mildred Pierce, she would burst into Christopher in my bedroom at 3 in the morning, screaming, "Fire drill! Fire drill!"
This novel idea is a pipe dream. Don't you know that?
What do you know? Nanny said my novel was brilliant.
Well, not brilliant, perhaps, but quite commercial, I'd say.
Then she pour on the curtain, gasoline, and set them on fire while we'd scream and scream. Ah! Ah!
You can't write, don't you know that?
What do you know? I can't, too.
Read them your first chapter, that'll show them.
I would try to untie Christopher, but Mommy wouldn't let me.
Chapter 1. I am born. I was born in a workhouse in London in 1853.
And the burning curtains came closer
and
closer to Christopher's
bed.
Cried
aloud,
"God, it's
coming!"
And then Mom took out the
wicked,
traveling
babies came by the door
and well,
snatched me up and left me at the
workhouse. And then the tears came streaming down her cheeks.
Mommy screamed, "Little Nell,
clean up your room! You made Mom ashamed of you! Bad Christina! Bad Christopher!
Will you be quiet? I am trying to read from my novel.
I'm reading to baby.
I don't care what you're doing. You're a guest in this house.
If you don't read to baby, it'll grow up with no love of literature.
It's my baby, and I'll raise it as I see fit.
No, it's my baby. I should have.
Give it back to me at once.
No, I won't. You're not good parents. I may have been negligent with my baby, but everyone makes mistakes. And I love baby. But you three are awful. You don't hold it when it cries. You dress it wrong so it can't even move. And you're both so inconsistent people, changing from one mood to another. You're obviously going to make it crazy, and that's why it never smiles.
No,
I may be forgetful, but baby has a chance with me.
Give it back.
No, don't move! I'll throw it out the window!
But Lord, she's insane!
Now, I'm leaving. I'm taking baby, and I'm taking the dog, and we're going to Florida, and you're not to follow us!
John, what should we do?
Could have another baby.
John, that's not practical. We can't do that.
I told you we shouldn't have let her stay here.
You said no such thing, and that's not the point now anyways. We have to go after her.
We're not dressed.
You're impossible.
You're right. I'm coming.
Well, I guess it's time for me to move on here. Nothing left to do but pack my little bag and go home. Oh, look. She left a little red thing in the jig. Caution. Contains lead, asbestos, and red dye number 2. Ew. Maybe it isn't meant as a child's toy after all. What would it be meant for, I wonder? Maybe it is a child's toy and all the cautionatory warning is simply satiric. It's hard to tell. So many mysteries. But children, they survive it all. They abide and they endure. They ebb and they flow.
We got it.
So did you.
Yes. That stupid girl ran right in front of a bus. Went right over her. Baby was lucky and fell between the wheels.
That was lucky.
Baby looks so startled. It's been a busy day, hasn't it?
Yes.
Nanny, Helen and I were talking as we ran back here, and things are going to be different. The immaturities of my youth are over. And I am going to take the responsibility of being a father and Helen of being a mother. And we're not letting any more crackpots into our home.
That's right, John.
And so we're going to have to ask you to leave. Helen and I have both decided that you're insane.
When it cries, you hold it, you should feed it. feed it regularly. Be consistent with it. Don't coo 1 minute and shout out the next.
And I'm giving up my career as a novelist to care for baby. Any resentment I feel, I won't ever show.
So that all sounds wonderful. Bye now.
Bye, Manny. We love you. Oh, John, I feel so lonely now.
Well, we have each other and baby.
That's right. Well, I wish I didn't have the baby and then written Scruples instead.
Well, I wish I were in McLean, but I thought we were going to be positive about things from now on.
Oh, okay. I feel better now. Look, baby looks so startled. It's been a terrifying day, hasn't it? Baby never seen a bus, let alone been under one. Don't worry, baby. Mommy will save you from buses and dogs and crazy people.
And Daddy loves you too, my little baked potato.
I told you not to call the baked potato!
Well, I'm sorry, but you mustn't raise your voice like that around the child. You'll make it deaf or something.
I'm sorry. I feel better now.
That's okay. We'll forget it. All over, baby. Oh, maybe, why won't it smile? Here's a toy. Maybe that will make it smile. Oh, why won't it smile? Smile for Daddy?
Or Mommy?
Will you smile for Mommy or Daddy?
Smile, baby!
Smile!
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 Smile! Oh, John, look, it's smiling.
That's right, baby.
I wonder if it's just pretending to smile to humor us.
I don't think it's that complicated.
Yes, but why would it smile when we shouted at it?
I don't know, maybe it's insane.
I wonder which it is, insane or humoring us.
Oh, look, it stopped smiling. Maybe the toy will make it smile. Oh, it's still not smiling. What a fussy baby.
Fussy baby.
Fussy, wussy baby.